I think the last speaker for this session is Professor Ambuj Sagar, IIT Delhi.
Good afternoon. I guess I'm the person standing between everybody and lunch. So there's additional pressure on me to try to be on time. I'm going to be talking from a slightly different perspective. I don't work on manufacturing. I basically work on thinking about, among other things, questions relating to energy. And as you will see, I think about innovation from a somewhat different perspective, not as an innovator, but somebody who thinks about stimulating innovation. So I'm a professor of policy studies, and so that's my my toolbox is really policies and other instruments to stimulate innovation, which in a sense is a counterpoint to the efforts of all the innovators in the room. I think it's, I'm not going to belabor this point. It's well understood. It's been mentioned by many other people that technology can actually help address numerous societal challenges. I just want to highlight a few points here that I think a fair amount of the conversation in this room, but also globally, is about accelerating this process because of the urgency of these challenges. Certainly for many of the kind of societal challenges we are talking about, especially relating to underprivileged or marginalized communities, the markets and other incentives for developing these kind of technologies are very weak or non-existent. There is a fair amount of activity going on, but certainly not sufficient in relationship to the scale of the challenges. And that's why you hear about all the exciting work that's going on, and then people are still saying that we have hundreds of millions of poor people, or actually billions, hundreds of millions just in India, and so on and so forth. The next point, and I think actually Daniel set me up very well, this notion of scaling up being absolutely key to realizing societal benefits, this turns out to be actually generally very, very difficult. It involves, in the literature, people talk about this notion of socio-technical transitions. But basically, diffusion, in a sense, really involves a lot of different things happening. People changing their preferences, people, communities having to reorganize themselves and so on. Often turns out to be much more complicated than is expected. In fact, I just want to make a small, a very nice phrase that I heard at a meeting in the UN a couple of years ago, where somebody was talking about the fact that we have lots of pilots and programs that never fail and never scale. And I think, in a sense, that really is the story of a lot of inclusive innovation. So at least from my point of view, systematic approach and innovation policy becomes critical to some of these questions. So let me come back to the question of energy. There are many dimensions of energy challenges, big question for actually most developing countries. But I'll just say that I think the three key areas is making sure there's greater amount of energy services available for people, that they can actually access them, they're affordable. And more we're also focused on problems of sustainability. And we can't address only just one of them. All three of them really have to be addressed at the same time. So it makes the energy challenge that much more complicated. I'm just going to throw up, I'm an ex-engineer, so I can't resist putting up some numbers. But just to give you a feel, and I'm just showing how India is doing compared to some of the other clusters in the world, whether OECD countries in the world, we're actually doing quite well. The solid lines is basically the left-hand side, which is energy use per unit GDP. It's effectively kind of energy efficiency of economic activity, where India has been actually improving quite significantly. But the dotted lines are electric power consumption per capita. Electric power consumption is used commonly as a measure of modern and clean energy availability. And there you see actually India is far beyond below the rest of the world and certainly the OECD countries. By the way, this is a problem not just for India. This is a problem that's common to a lot of other developing countries. This is some projections from the International Energy Agency. Basically, under business as usual conditions, and we actually see that even in the year 2030, we expect almost a billion people to still not have access to electricity, and maybe something of the order of 2.5 billion people to not have access to clean cooking facilities. Enormous implications for in a lot of different areas. What I want to do is to just spend my remaining few minutes in just putting out a few examples of how different ways to stimulate innovation and promote a scale-up of energy technologies. I think a couple of people have already talked about this notion household cooking, cooking energy derived from biomass in India and many other developing countries. Huge problem in terms of health. A colleague with whom I do some work in this area, who has been actually working on this for the last 35 years, he actually says that having a cook stove, a biomass cook stove in a kitchen, is the equivalent of having burning 400 cigarettes an hour in that room, because the pollutants are more or less the same. And so effectively a huge health problem. There's been a fair amount of effort at this, but the point is most biomass cook stoves have not yielded the kind of solutions that can protect human health adequately. So I and some colleagues came up with this idea of developing an innovation prize, which is basically a way of stimulating innovation. You put out a big challenge out there, hopefully with enough of a financial incentive, and get all kinds of players to think about solutions that you may not be able to a priori generate through a standard R&D centered approach. Actually, the Indian Ministry of New and Renewable Energy and the World Bank and the Tata Trust are thinking about implementing such a solution. I have two asterisks there just to highlight the fact that this area of clean cook stoves, clean biomass cook stoves, has been a huge area in the last few years. The reality is, I myself, having now been working this area and having proposed this kind of an innovation prize, I'm kind of coming to the conclusion that this may be the wrong answer. And this is one of those areas I want to just highlight where a focus on a technological solution may actually blind you to something that's already there. So turns out that at the same time, a standard approach has been other clean cooking is through liquid petroleum gas. I think actually Anil talked about his stove on burning clean kerosene, but that's another certainly a solution. But clean LPG has been the solution. In fact, every rich family in India, and in fact, any well-off person in the world, across the world, are using gas in their house, mostly, right? So we've actually been working with the Indian government in the meanwhile, while waiting for the next generation super clean cook stove innovation to happen, is to think about scaling up LPG. And there, actually, the innovation is not technological. There, the innovation is thinking about subsidies more intelligently than we've used before, and starting to use other forms of financing to push for the diffusion of LPG. The Bureau of Energy Efficiency in India has done some very interesting work in driving down the price of technology in LEDs and super efficient fans, and therefore combining that also with diffusion programs effectively to both help in the development of new technologies and their diffusion to drive scale. They've done the same with labeling and standards, another policy instrument, to enhance the deployment of energy efficient appliances and therefore enhance reduce the requirement for energy. Selco, an NGO in India, has been very, very successful in innovating with various delivery models to provide solar powers for the poor. Again, two asterisks here to say that this is kind of interesting. India has a very aggressive and significant solar energy program. But that solar energy program is driven by really focused on industrial development and developing an industry around solar PV technology and trying to also do concentrated solar thermal. But this goes back to your question of the vision. You know, how do you, these are both the idea of the cook stove and the solar power. It's a vision of what you want to do with the technology. The cook stove, actually, we are being driven a lot by climate change. Biomass cook stoves address the climate challenge, but not the health challenge, so they are still seen as a kind of a desirable solution. In the case of solar power, actually, industrialization is seen as, in a sense, an implicit objective. And focusing, there's not as much of a focus on using solar energy to help rural people. So I think this question of how do you think about the objective that you start with, really, and that's the point I was making earlier about framing, actually pushes you in different directions and may lead to very, very different solutions. And last but not the least, I want to also mention this idea of, and again, I think it's you made the same point also, Daniel, is thinking about how do you support all the sets of activities that are needed, not just technology development, but also the other activities that are needed to enhance diffusion, whether it's delivery models, business models, whether it's thinking about all the policies and all of that. And in order to do that, actually, this is an idea that I had actually put out, which is this notion of a climate innovation center, which is an organizational form. So in a sense, an organizational innovation, which is intended really to provide systematic and strategic support across the technology cycle to promote the development and diffusion of clean technologies. This idea has now been taken up by the World Bank, and they're putting up a series of climate innovation centers in different parts of the world. So I just want to end with that, in that while I think we're all interested in thinking about how to stimulate inclusive innovation, inclusive manufacturing, and part of that, obviously, the innovators and the technologists are at front and center in that. I think if you step back and take a systemic perspective, a system-wide perspective, I think we'll find that there are many other actually activities that we also probably need to engage in, and certainly innovation policies and other policies to help promote and stimulate this kind of activity and drive it to scale. Thank you.